Hello, we're going to be talking about logic gates in this video and going through some examples of how you might answer exam questions on logic gates. So what is a logic gate itself? Well, a logic gate is a circuit that implements a Boolean operator. A Boolean operator is used in a Boolean expression, and we looked at how they work in the last video. We've got four basic ones we're going to be learning about. There are other Boolean operators as well, not too many more, but a few more which use combinations of these operators. And a logic gate actually implements it in a computer, because if I want to be able to perform Boolean expressions, which I do for things like if statements and while loops and do until loops, I need to have circuitry which can perform these Boolean operators. And those are what logic gates are. A CPU, specifically an ALU, have loads and loads of little circuits, which are logic gates, which can perform these operations. Now, happily, as a computer scientist, we don't really get into the detail of how these work or how they are actually physically created. That's more of a job for an electrical engineer. We just draw little symbols to represent these different logic gates. So we can combine these different logic gates together to perform more complicated operations. We'll look at how we can create an addition circuit later in this playlist, which is just a combination of a few of these different gates. You need to learn the shapes of these logic gates and what they represent. So NOT only has one input, got a triangle and a circle at the end. Don't forget the circle, that is part of it. XOR and OR are very similar in operation. XOR is just our more exclusive version. The only difference is we've got another curved line at the back of XOR. XOR is kind of like a crescent moon-ish, that's how I think of it. Whereas AND has got this vertical line on the left-hand side. And that's our four logic gates to learn. Like I say, we are not ever looking at these in isolation, really. We're trying to combine these together to perform different operations or to mimic a real life logical scenario. The ALU will have these connected together in various different ways to perform different instructions. So here is an example, what might be described as a logic circuit, a logic diagram. And a typical question given something like this might be, write the logic expression represented by the below logic circuit. And to answer this, you'll need to know obviously what these gates are representing, but also need to think about the order of operations here as well. So logic expression just means Boolean expression. They are meaning the same thing, so don't get caught out by that. I've got one output here, which is O. We often write our outputs on the right-hand side, but I'm going to personally do it on the left just because I want to kind of work backwards-ish. Now we can either use a standard equal sign here, or we can also use a fancy triple equal sign. This means equivalence. The difference between equivalence and equal is very tedious to read up on. It's not super important, just we often use equivalence in this topic. If you used equals, there's not really much difference, to be honest. So my output is equal to what? Well, what gates have I got? I might start by labeling my diagram of what gates I've got. I've got an XOR right at the end. I've got an AND here. I've got an OR here, and I've got two NOT gates on the left-hand side. And I've got three inputs in this example, which is more than we've looked at so far, A, B, and C. So where I look at this is sort of work backwards, really. We've got XOR feeding into our output. XOR has got two inputs, right, which will go either side of XOR. So we've got two inputs, two pathways leading into XOR. I'm going to leave a gap for those either side. Let's do the top strand first. So we have an AND gate straight away, which again is going to need to have two inputs. So I've left space either side. The bottom input for AND here is being fed in from B. You can see the same wire is being fed in from B. So therefore, B is one of our inputs to this AND gate. What is our other input? Well, our other input is NOT A. So NOT A is our other input. So I'm going to put NOT A on the left-hand side. Now, thinking about our order of operations, we always do NOT first, then we do AND, then we do XOR. So actually here, I don't need to add any brackets, although it may help you to add brackets if it's going to help you sort of visualize it. Well, what about this other strand? So the bottom strand down here, well, we've got an OR gate. So again, I need to put an OR gate on the left-hand side. I might run out of space here. And then I've got B also going into this OR gate. So the wire splits, B is also getting fed into this OR gate. So I'll just put B on the right-hand side again. And at the bottom, it's a very similar setup. I've got NOT C this time being fed into it. Squeeze in NOT C right at the bottom. Again, order of operations wise, this is okay, but you might, for clarity, add some brackets to make it a little bit clearer about what's going on. That is common to add brackets, even if you don't necessarily need to. Now, I did this expression by writing out the full words, not X or AND. The equivalent, an equivalent way of writing it would be using our shorthand symbols, which actually would be quicker to write out. So NOT C is this NOT symbol. I can't really describe it, but that symbol. OR is like a V. I've got B. XOR is another V, but underlined. Then I've got another NOT A. AND is an inverted V, like that. Then I've got B on the end. So you can see this version is a little bit more concise. You might prefer to write that in the exam, unless you were told you could write either. Another example might be where instead of it giving you the diagram, it does the opposite. So it gives you a expression and tells you to write it or draw it as a logic gate diagram. So here we're given Q as our output and X, Y, and Z are our three inputs. So let me do a Q on the right hand side. Our outputs always go on the right and our inputs always go on the left. You could draw a box if you wanted to, but it's not super important. Now, what gates have I got here? Well, I've got a NOT Z. So Z is getting knotted straight away. We're looking at, again, order of precedence. So NOT comes first. So I'm looking at this first of all. I've got a NOT coming straight out of Z. So let me draw a NOT gate as neat as I can. I always struggle with this. NOT gate, one input, one output. Okay, now what comes next? Is it the OR? Is it the AND? Well, it's going to be the AND because of my order of precedence. So therefore, Z is going to be connected up to Y with an AND gate. Let me draw an AND gate here in a way that I can connect in the Z and also connect in the Y. And then because of the order of operations, really, I've done that first of all. So now I've got X OR all of what I've just done. So I need to draw an OR gate to wrap this up like this. This is the one I'm worst at. Draw an OR gate to wrap it up. The OR gate is going to feed into Q because I'm done at this point. X is going to feed into it as one of our inputs. And the output from this AND gate is going to feed in as the other input. Make sure, with the exception of NOT gates, all of these other gates have got two inputs and one output. This is how they work. So don't forget our order of operations because it would affect you in questions like this. Now, an expression like this is effectively meaningless. Like, what on earth does this circuit do? I've got no idea. I just made this up earlier. Like, it doesn't mean anything. However, we could be designing circuits based on some real life logic. And occasionally questions will try and mimic this by giving you a bit of a scenario and asking you to interpret it and draw the logic based on it. So here, a clothes retailer offers a 10% discount if the customer is 21 or younger or is aged 65 and older. Customers who don't match these criteria also get the same discount if they have paid for the premium service. And we're told to draw a logic circuit that represents this logic. Well, the letters we've used so far, I've got no connection at all to a scenario like this. So therefore, I need to assign some letters to different parts of this scenario. And I'm picking apart what things in the scenario are Boolean. What things can either be true or false? Well, perhaps let's start with our output. Let's just label Q as our output because that's what we use most often. Well, our Q could represent what? What is our output here? The output is whether they have a 10% discount. That is the output. And because I'm assigning different letters to expressions, often we write the word let. So let Q be equal to having a 10% discount. What else is important to check here? Well, what else is Boolean? Well, they're going to potentially be 21 or younger. So let's do Y for younger. Let's say is 21 or younger. We also have if they are age 65 or older. So let's do an O for that. Then we have customers who don't match these criteria also getting the same discount if they have paid for a premium service. So let's do P as premium service. You might find the exam questions sort of do this assignment job for you, but you might also need to do it to answer the question. So now I've assigned my Boolean variables, I can start to actually think about, well, what operators connect up these different letters? Well, Q is our output, so it's always going to go on our right-hand side. And my inputs here are Y, O, and P. So how are these combined together to give us the output? Well, first of all, one path to having a 10% discount is if you are 21 or younger or you're age 65 and older. Now, it is not possible to be both 21 and younger and also 65 and older. So actually, we could use an OR operator here, but an OR operator is almost impossible because you can't be both. So OR being true and both inputs are true isn't actually really helpful because you can't be both of these two things. So I would argue an XOR is probably most suitable here because you can't be both of these two things. An XOR wouldn't be true if both were true. So perhaps I want to draw an XOR gate between Y and O. Let me do that now and let's do an XOR. Got to concentrate because I'm rubbish at drawing. That's not a great effort, but let's pretend that is a nice smooth crescent moon type shape. I've got to do the other line at the back to make sure it is XOR, not OR. XOR has got two inputs, which in here are Y and O. Now, customers who don't match these criteria also get the same discount if they have paid for the premium service. So this should be, you know, if P is true, we want to get Q as true. Because if Q is true, it means they have a 10% discount. Well, it's tempting to read maybe too much into this don't match bit. You might be tempted to do something like not Y and not O. But I think it's a little bit overcomplicating it here because essentially, what are the paths to having a 10% discount? Well, either you are within a certain age range or you've paid for the premium service. And it's possible for both of those things to be true at the same time. And that's not really a problem. So let's do an OR gate to connect up these last bits because we only need one of these things to be true. If both are true, not really a problem. And then I can connect up this OR gate to the Q, and that should be my slightly squashed up, that should be my circuit, which represents this scenario. Now that thing about XOR is a little bit subjective. The Mark scheme might allow you to use OR there. Likewise, the Mark scheme might allow you to do a couple of NOTs to make sure this was if you don't match. But in my head, this represents this scenario. And so as long as it is logical, you'd be given marks for it in an exam.